Buick and Together have teamed up to increase representation and gender equality in sports because girls everywhere deserve a chance to play on a level field. Join the conversation as we see her greatness.
So grateful to be here. Obviously, on behalf of Buick, Buick has been the proud sponsor of the entire NCAA since 1970, which is so amazing. So welcome, of course, to our Buick Huddle, also in partnership with Together. I'm Brooke Baldwin. Let me take a seat and get comfy. I actually wrote a book called Huddle about the collective power of women, and I talked to a bunch of athletes. So, you know, if you like reading books and want to talk about powerful women, I can do that with you. But let's be real, you're not here for me, you're here for them. So let me tee them up, these two volleyball legends. First up, in the beautiful purple sweater, she was a high school three-year letter winner, an all-state and all-American winner, and an all-state selection in basketball, and a four-time state champion in track and field. At Stanford, she was the Pac-10 Freshman of the Year and became one of the most distinguished performers in the program's history. Is it fun to hear? Like, this is a lot. I'm only, like, just getting started. She was nominated as the top female athlete for three consecutive years with the highest hitting proficiency mark of any NCAA Division I player. She has competed in club volleyball overseas for 12 seasons. During her time overseas, she played in Japan, Russia, Azerbaijan, and Switzerland. Please give it up for Foluke Akinradewo. Right here. In our presence. But I'm not done. Our next volleyball legend found the game by accident. We're so gonna talk about this. While hanging out with a best friend at volleyball camp, she walked onto the court and apparently never left. In her distinguished high school sports career, she paced her squad to Division I state championships in both volleyball and also basketball at the University of Texas.
Woo! Oh my God, this is really loud.
As a sophomore starter, middle blocker, in 31 matches, her hitting percentage led the team. As a junior, she started every single game, ranking number one in hitting in NCAA D1 statistics, on the way to four college first-team rosters, two Big 12 Player of the Week awards, as well as ACVA All-American first-team honors, and has played for clubs around the world, including Turkey, Italy, and Brazil. Ladies and gentlemen, Rachael Adams. My goodness, I need some water after those incredible introductions. Thank you so much for being here, both of you. And thank you so much for being here. I know you've been following, you know, the game so far. You know, within Buick, we talk a lot about, you know, moments of greatness and seeing her greatness. Rachael, first you, and then Foluke. Like, just talk to me about what one moment of greatness would you want to shout out so far from all the play we've seen?
I would love to shout out just the amazing teams that are here. It's just a diversity of the teams that are here. A lot of teams haven't been here in the past. The game is growing. The teams are getting stronger. The competition is getting stronger. The players are getting stronger. And I just want to commend the girls for all that they have put into the sport, especially the ones that have stayed for a fifth year just because they love the game and they're committed to seeing the sport grow and to their goals. And I want to commend the super seniors, definitely.
No coincidence that you're shouting out the teams that are here, of which you graduated.
I mean, Texas, you know.
Foluke, what about you? A moment of greatness.
Yeah, I have been following along. The Elite Eight was very exciting. I think there's so many moments of greatness throughout. One main one, I would say, was watching Louisville play Oregon in that Elite Eight, being down, you know, in that fourth set, potentially going home, yeah. Bouncing back from that, winning a fifth set. And then also the way they performed in the semis and, you know, going in a fifth set, dominating in the fifth. So it's been really impressive to see, you know, teams with their backs against the walls and how they respond to that. And I think they've done a great job.
When you're watching these various games, have you been able to say, boom, she's definitely professional potential? Like, is that easy to tell? Have you spotted anyone? You don't have to name names, but can you see some women emerging?
I'd say absolutely. I think there's a plethora of women that are playing right now that you look at them and you say, like, for sure. And I think even more than that, I think there's players that maybe are under their radar right now and are going to develop even more.
I just can't imagine being in the locker room right now, right? This is the most exciting moment in some of these women's professional, or I'm thinking ahead for them, in their collegiate careers. Take us inside the locker room. Like, what are you, at this moment, like, what are you listening to? Are you talking to anyone? Are you zoned out, like, in your own zone? What are you eating? Like, tell me everything.
I think it's keeping to what you've been doing. I think once you start thinking like, okay, it's a national championship day, I need to do this and this and that or do more, that's when you kind of start to lose your control within it all. So when you control what you can control and you sit in what you've been doing, that is where you like find your strength and where you find your groundedness.
Sort of normalize this grand moment.
Exactly. Yeah, as much as you possibly can, be like, it's the ball's the same size. That's what we were taught. Like, the ball's the same size, and that's the same height. Court's the same size. Don't try to make it bigger than it is. You don't need to do anything more, anything less. It's all within you. Just do what you do.
Do you all hear that? That's good. That's good advice.
Yeah.
What would you be doing in the locker room right now?
I would say, I think honoring how you're feeling, because there's going to be nerves. Like, that's the game. You know, you're playing in a big stage, there's gonna be nerves. Honoring that and accepting it, like, hey, I feel nervous right now, that's fine, but what got me here? My good is good enough, and I think that definitely helps. I think oftentimes with athletes, we've been told to push that aside, like, no, you've got this, you're strong, like, it's okay. It's okay if I'm not strong. I can rely on my teammates, and that's the great thing about playing the sport that we play. You can rely on other people to get you through it.
What are, Foluke, what are the biggest changes you've seen in some of these women athletes today versus when you were playing at Stanford?
Mental health, of, you know, knowing if you're not okay, relying on each other, and what you were talking about, like, your good is good enough, and having that mindset. I don't know if we were necessarily there.
Like, as open and discussing it
as open
when
and
you were
discussing
in school.
It when I was in school.
That's huge what Foluke said, like, accept how you're feeling, because people tell you to push it down, but once you say, like, hi, fear, I hear you, I hear what you're saying. You're saying, like, what if something bad happens? What if we lose? Once you, like, say hi to it and you welcome it, then it, like, settles down.
We've got a life coach in our midst, just in case you didn't know. I'm totally serious, she is. What was it like when you were playing for Texas?
They had never been to a Final Four when I committed.
Wow.
So
you took a risk.
To see, but I saw where they were going. And so to see where they are now and to be a part of that, it's amazing. But what really led us along the way and how we approached like being a normal Final Four team is we focused on one game at a time and not getting ahead of ourselves.
What is a normal Final Four
team? Well, I mean, just being accustomed, you know? Like, you know the routine. Like, these girls know how to be like, oh, we're packing for the Final Four. I know it's a pack. You know, like, you know, I know who to call. I know, like, what to do. But I didn't know that. We were like, oh, my God, the Final Four. Like, what do we do? Like, you know? So until I knew, like, what that was, but we had to like build our mindsets.
Let's talk about also just the incredible momentum that this sport has had, really just even in the last year or two. By the way, I think this is sold out, okay? This is where we're at. How do you all think that all this momentum and success can really like, poof, bring this more mainstream, have everyone talking about collegiate volleyball?
Interest for the game has always been there. You look at, you know, female youth sports is the number one team sport for youth athletes.
But something changed. Something feels different.
Something feels different. I feel like there is that momentum. I think having, you know, we always talked about how, you know, we have our collegiate careers and everyone, we're household names when we're in college and we go overseas and no one knows anything about us unless you're fortunate enough to make the Olympic team and then they'll see you once every 4 years. But now, you know, with the introduction of leagues, professional leagues, people are able to play at home and people are able to see their favorite athletes play at home, and you know, the viewership is increasing, and with more viewership comes more endorsements, and I just think it's just helping grow the game even more.
When you're in bed at night, you close your eyes and you're playing the reel that is your life thus far, what is the moment when you're like, I crushed that?
Being able to like feel strongly, being able to play next to Foluke, just be able to feel comfortable, like, hey, I've put in a lot of work and I'm excited to be able to stand with these strong women and be able to like take up space and, you know.
That translates off the court.
Yeah, it translates off the court. And, you know, it's so easy to doubt ourselves as players. And to get to that point where I was just like, took a deep breath. I'm like, okay, I feel good. I feel like I can be what they need me to be, and I can be of service to her and of my teammates and stand strong into that. It was a good feeling to be able to know that I can contribute to what the team needs me to do with confidence.
You know how to huddle.
Yeah.
You know how to huddle. How about you? Highlight.
I would definitely be coming back from, you know, giving birth, motherhood.
Oh,
for sure.
Yeah.
How about that?
Yes. I mean, and it was a struggle, as any mom knows, you know, like coming back, being a mom, period, is difficult.
Women are incredible.
And it honestly, becoming a mom, like, changed my view on women, and it shouldn't have, but it did, and just, like, how, like, badass we really are.
Coming back from this, what is it like for you at your level?
Right. So for me, with my pregnancy, I developed diastasis, which is the separation of your abdomen. So I had no core. And with volleyball, core is very important. So that was my biggest challenge. Physically, I felt great, you know, like I felt like I was in good shape and everything, but I couldn't get any power. And so on top of being a mom, breastfeeding, pumping on my way to practice, like doing all that stuff, then I was like, okay, how do I get my core back and try and make this team?
Yes. Did you do that, Foluke?
I did.
You did.
I did.
You did. Both of you are married. Both of you have had these extraordinary international careers. How do you do that? How do you do that?
Having a partner that understands the nature of this game, our career, what it takes. I know for me, I could not have accomplished what I accomplished in the past 2 years without my husband. He was my rock. He helped take care of my son when I was away. I was gone for months. I think having relationships is hard in general. Long distance makes it even more difficult, but having a partner that's going to be on your side and understand what you're going to go through helps a lot. He didn't play professionally like your husband, but he played basketball in college, understands the game.
Yes.
And so I think that's helped a lot.
Understands the commitments for athletes.
Absolutely.
How about you?
Yeah, I mean, exactly what she said, just having that understanding, that support, and being able to like make sacrifices for us. Like, my husband is also a professional athlete, so during off season, he would be in California with me when, you know, he really wanted to be home with his family during his off season, being around like his people too.
Yeah.
So we had to make sacrifices, and now I'm in Japan with him, supporting him in his journey. So it's just a give and take as we go on our journey, and just to have that support, like she said, I wouldn't have been able to get through a lot of moments that I was able to without him by my side. Especially since we kind of like walk the same journey too.
Yes, so good. You know, one of the reasons we're also here, and we've been cultivating these conversations with Buick and together all year at all the various national championships. And the question I asked throughout, and I'm curious your responses, is I know everyone agrees with me sitting here, is we care about women in sports. We care about, you know, days like today, and we need to have more. Having been in media for 2 decades, I know this. Like, there should be more media coverage of women in sports, and in particularly at the collegiate level. How can we as fans, as allies, help you?
I think continuing what's, you know, talk about this trend of the increase in interest and viewership, and I just think increasing that. If there's a match on TV, watch it, tell your friends about it, you know, like get more people involved and into the game and learning about players and what they're doing. And I think the more we do that, the more it's going to grow. Because, like I said, the interest is there. People, I mean, it's an awesome game. That's why I started playing it, just watching it and being a part of it. And so I know that the more people get involved, the more we talk about it, the more we watch it, the more it's going to grow.
My journey, or like how that goal was born, was when I saw the games on TV. She was there, and she had played obviously college at the same time as me. And I was like, wait, I was just on the same kind of like court as her, and now I see her on TV.
Yeah.
I was like, the path was like illuminated in my head.
Yes.
So if I never saw that on TV, it would have never connected. So
the path was illuminated.
Yeah, and so we need to continue to illuminate these paths for young female athletes, for dreams to be born by them seeing, you know, even just female athletes and women that look like them, that have, you know, I've played with teammates that have had different like disabilities, and so if they're like, oh my God, they can do that too, like I can do that. And so the connections are being made. See it, be it.
Yes.
It needs to be out there more. So tell the stories, share the stories, just post, repost, retweet everything.
Yes. Rachael, I want to stay with you because obviously I've been stalking you on the socials as I outed myself earlier. Tell us about you as the mindset and confidence mentor, and what is JourneyStrength.com?
For me, I started Journey Strength in 2016, and it came from me realizing that my mindset almost held me back. I had a coach come up to me in 2015 saying, why does it look like you don't deserve to take up space on the court? Like, you don't deserve to be out there. And it just kickstarted me on a path of, you know, why do I have self-doubt? Why am I not taking up space on the court? And I dove into mindset, and luckily we had a sports psychologist. We talked about self-talk, and that allowed me to dive even deeper into the thoughts that I had. Our thoughts are powerful, and I realized how powerful they were, and I realized they almost held me back from doing what I needed to do and being what I need to be for my teammates and be able to show up in the way that I wanted to show up.
Yep.
So once I saw the power, I wanted to give back to female athletes and provide them with those encouraging words. And now I'm a mindset and confidence mentor to female athletes, and I work with them one-on-one. And I am working with an athlete that's actually here at the national championship, just to have her connect and be like, hey, I'm nervous.
Yes.
I'm like, I got you, yes. You know? And just to be able to be a source and like talk with her through that and be like, nerves, like Luke Feluca said, nerves are normal.
Yes.
You know?
Nerves are normal.
And to hear that from someone who's been on the biggest stages, she's like, oh, shoot, like, nerves are normal. I got, you know, like just the reminding of what she's been working on throughout this journey.
Yes.
And so to be able to provide that for her and to be a source, that's all I want to do.
Yes.
Encouragement, and don't let their thoughts hold them back from what they want to do.
How did you get into this by accident? I wanted to loop back on that.
Yeah, you started. I was spending the night at my best friend's house.
How old were you?
I was an incoming freshman volleyball player. We woke up, she asked me, do you want to sleep in? Do you want to come with me to incoming freshman volleyball camp? I called my mom. I was like, hey, mom, this is what's up. She's like, make a decision. Let me know. I'll come pick you up. They didn't have Uber back then.
Yeah.
So it was like, your mom is, you know,
yes, your lifeline.
And so I decided to go. I brought my summer reading book. And then I got there. I asked the coaches, is it okay if I sit on the sideline and read my book? And they're like, cool. 5 minutes later, they asked me if I wanted to jump in, if I wanted to join. And I said, okay. It was tragic. Since I started so late, I carried these beliefs that like I wasn't enough, but it also pushed me to want to get better every single day because I was like, I need to learn, and I just became addicted.
There was a picture you had posted of, it was your little boy. Your caption was, waiting for all of this to feel real. Feluca, when did it feel real? Does it feel real?
I think now that I'm retired, I can sit back and be like, oh, wow, this all happened. This is really, I accomplished things. This is cool. But in the moment, I never felt like I've arrived, which I think has been to a benefit. I never got complacent. I, you know, up until my last week of retirement, I taught myself a new block move and a new technique. And I was like, man, if I had, you know, I was still learning. Like, man, if I had known this, you know, years back, I'd be a much better blocker. But, you know, it was like always having that growth mindset. I never felt good enough, you know? So not to say that I lacked confidence, but I never felt like I arrived.
Mm.
And I don't know if it's because I started the game late, and so I was, you know, playing catch up the whole time, but I never felt like I had done it yet.
Yeah.
And so now I can sit back and look and be like, oh yeah, okay, I did some things, but in the moment, never.
I know you all have questions. These are legendary players. Don't be shy. Who's gonna be the first?
So you guys are in fabulous shape, so I know you take care of yourself.
Mm.
But I wanna know, what's your favorite cheat foods?
Favorite cheat foods.
I know one.
Are they considered cheat foods, or are they just like just food?
I think everything carbs for you, right?
I love me some carbs. Oh yeah, I love
Which carbs?
Any carb.
Are we talking blueberry muffins, pancakes?
Pizza. Cinnamon rolls. We were talking about this. I was blessed with a really high metabolism, so I know it's not fair.
Not fair.
Don't listen to her.
But you know, as my career progressed, I definitely became more nutrition conscious. But in the beginning,
her plate wasn't colorful for a very long time.
It was very. And then it became colorful.
A lot of beige.
Very beige. I don't know. I eat with moderation. If it's there, I'll eat it. I don't feel bad about it. Cake. I don't do dairy, so like vegan ice cream, whatever. Yeah, candy. I eat it all.
Who else? Who else? Who else? Who else? Who else?
I mean, Foluke, I've heard you talk about it before, but both of you can. What kind of influence did your family have, your parents have on your career?
I mean, I feel like you already know this, Cass. My parents, I'm a first generation. My parents were born and raised in Nigeria. And so they made the sacrifice of coming to North America to give us a better life and to give us more opportunity. And so for me, throughout my career, it was about honoring that sacrifice that they made, because to leave all your family and come here, you know, takes a lot. I can only imagine, because we as athletes go overseas for a little period of time and how difficult that is. So I always tried to honor that. My parents never pushed me into sport, which was great. Everything was academics, and so they're like, if you want to play, fine. Like, if you don't,
all right,
okay,
all right, human biology, major at Stanford.
Yeah, they didn't care, but they supported me with whatever I did. So, yeah, I just always tried to honor that, and the hard days, like, that was my why, was to honor their sacrifice.
Yes, yes. Rachel, family influence?
Yeah, I mean, I'm thankful that my parents also never really pushed me. They never emailed a coach asking why I'm not playing. In that aspect, it allowed me to grow, go through the ups and downs, and also be the driver of my career and my force. They knew I was going to be tall, so they always tried to instill confidence in me. My dad would put me on his shoulders and be like, okay, you're going to be tall one day, just like get used to being up here, like no slouching. You know, I don't know why, but he had me doing push-ups, trying to make me mentally strong. But they just tried to instill confidence and just believe that I can do anything and nothing is too big. And I definitely held that. Like, yes, I had moments in my career where I wasn't taking up space, but within all of that, deep down, I was like, I can do this. I just have like some blocks. So just being able to instill confidence, instill the belief in the journey, and just this endless amount of support.
Last question is just like, what does joy look like for both of you off the court? What's joy?
For me, just like the normal, everyday, like just peace, like the moments of like still and relaxation and maybe not really out to achieve, like just being, and that's what I'm trying to sit more in 2023, because as an athlete, you want to achieve.
It's always forward thinking.
It's always forward thinking, and I think I find the most joy in just being and being present with those around me, and I want to like dive deeper into that, definitely.
I would say kind of something similar, but I'm a big introvert, if you guys didn't know. But I like being, you know, I like alone time.
Yes.
I like recharging that way. I like obviously being around family and close friends. And I think in the moments where I can have that, I get a lot of joy.
Yes. Foluke Akinradewo, Rachael Adams, thank you both so, so much.
Thank you, guys.
Thank you. Together. You guys, make sure when you take your photos of your favorite athletes, hashtag see her greatness. Every bit of visibility really helps, you know, in this conversation that we've been having. So Buick and together, thank you, thank you, thank you.